friends, welcome to the Biological Life Sciences channel. Today in this video we are going to see what is post-transcriptional modifications. So there are three types of post-translational modifications that we are going to see today. First is capping. Second is tailing. That is also called as polyadenylation. Then splicing. Now let us see what is capping. Now let's see the process of capping in details. Okay, so this is the mRNA first. You can see this is the 5' end of mRNA that is synthesized. And this is the 3' end of mRNA. Okay, so the 3' end is kept on synthesizing still. Okay. When 20 to 30 nucleotides of the mRNA are synthesized, at that time only the process of capping begins, because the 5' end of mRNA has to be protected. Okay, now this is the 5' end and there is some nucleotide at the 5' end, therefore it is taken as nucleotide triphosphate, because always the first nucleotide will be in triphosphate form. And here the first phosphorus group attached to the ribose sugar here is alpha phosphorus, then beta phosphorus and then gamma phosphorus. Okay, so first of all the process of capping initiates with the phosphohydrolase, that is one phosphate group, that is this gamma phosphorus from the mRNA 5' end is removed. Okay, see this is inorganic phosphate that is removed. Now it becomes double P. Okay, you can see only alpha and beta phosphorus is remaining. Okay, now what happens, guanyl transferase enzyme, what it does, it transfers the guanyl group, GTP, that is guanosine triphosphate, it transfers the group. Okay, the thing is here at the 5' end the guanine nucleotide that is added in an inverted manner. Okay, so normally what happens when a triphosphate is added with another triphosphate, the bond is formed, that is 5'3' end. Okay, so this is the phosphodiester bond, okay, regular phosphodiester bond in the DNA, but here a different bond is formed since the guanyl transferase enzyme incorporates the guanine at 5' end in an invert manner. So therefore the 5' end of this guanine or 5' phosphate of this guanine attaches to the 5' end of this nucleotide. So it's a 5' triphosphate bond formed here, which is not a normal bond that is synthesized here. Okay, so therefore what it does, it blocks the reactive 5' end of the mRNA strand, thereby protecting the end. Okay, let's see how it happens. You can see addition of GTP here. So GTP also has three phosphorus groups, alpha, beta and gamma. Okay, now the beta and gamma phosphorus from here is removed in the pyrophosphate form. Okay, pyrophosphate form, the two phosphates are removed, and now this phosphorus along with this alpha and beta present from the previous nucleotide or the starting nucleotide at the 5' end, it is attached at this position. You can see here it is attached at this position. So here again it becomes triphosphate. Okay, so the guanine residue attaches here at this starting position, and this is done by the enzyme called as guanyl transferase. So this is the 5' cap that is synthesized here. Okay, now guanine is a multi-ring structure. It has a hexameric ring and a pentameric ring attached together. Okay, so at the 7th position there is a presence of nitrogen here. So at the 7th position there is an attachment of methyl group now. Okay, so this methyl group is donated here by S adenosyl methionine. Okay, S adenosyl methionine, this gives the methyl group here, and using the enzyme guanine 7 methyl transferase, what happens, this methyl group is added at the 7th position nitrogen of guanine. Okay, so once the methyl group is attached here at 7th position, it protects the guanine residue, and moreover it also protects the 5' end in a enhanced manner. Again, to protect it more properly, what happens, there is addition of another methyl group that is again donated by S adenosyl methionine. Okay, you can see. So now this is attached to the first nucleotide. Okay, okay. So the first nucleotide, you know, first nucleotide was also having certain base. Okay, so add the nitrogen of that ribose sugar. Sorry, not add the carbon of that ribose sugar in hydroxyl group, the second number hydroxyl group, that is 2' hydroxyl group, methyl group is added. So therefore the enzyme is called as 2-hydroxyl methyl transferase. Okay, So whatever the ribose sugar that is present at the starting, the methyl group of that ribose sugar present at the 2' end, which is a reactive group, is added with the methyl group by the enzyme methyl transferase, thereby protecting. Okay. So the addition of guanine is called first cap. GTP is called first cap. Then addition of this methyl group is called second cap, and the addition of methyl group at the first nucleotide or the first base of mRNA is called third cap. So this is the whole process of capping. Now let's see the process of tailing in prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Let's see tailing now. So this is the mRNA at the starting. Here you can see the 5' guanosine cap is already formed till the mRNA synthesis is completed. Okay, so this is the poly A signal. Yes, the poly A signal is AAU AAA. Okay, this is regarded as the poly A signal. Okay, in eukaryotes. Okay, so when this poly A signal is reached, you can see here the mRNA synthesis is going on now, and this poly A signal is encountered onto the template. Okay, so now the poly A signal is synthesized, and then afterwards there is a stretch of UUU around 20 nucleotides. Okay, so 20 nucleotide stretch of UUU is there on the 3' end of mRNA that is prescribed by the template strand. Okay, now what happens here? You can see this, once the poly A signal will form in the mRNA, then after that the AAA signal is there. Okay, so there is a factor called as CPSF. This factor is called CPSF. It is cleavage and polyadenylation specificity factor. Cleavage and polyadenylation specificity factor binds to the template strand and rides along the template till the transcription process is going on. And once the mRNA or the template strand encounters this poly A signal, it comes and binds at this position. Okay, so now it binds along with another enzyme called as endonuclease enzyme. What this endonuclease does, it cuts right at this position just after 10 base pair from the poly A signal site. Poly A signal site, once the poly A signal site is synthesized, it cuts around 10 base pairs after that. So it will be cutting here. Okay, so at this position, the mRNA is dissociated from the template and the CPSF remains binds there, and the strand is then closed again. The mRNA is removed from there. Okay, so now this 5' guanosine cap is already formed. Okay, but the 3' end of mRNA is still vulnerable to be attacked by different exonuclease enzymes. So to protect that, immediately next enzyme, that is poly A polymerase, it binds at this position from the 3' end. Okay, so now this 3' end is binded with the another polymerase that is called poly A polymerase, that adds around 200 to 250 bases of adenine one by one. Okay, so when this adds this much bases of adenine one by one, so it becomes a poly A tail. So around 200 to 250 base pair of poly A tail is there at the 3' end. Now the mRNA is also protected from 3' end as well as 5' end, because there are number of adenine at that 3' end. Then what will happen when the synthesis is occurring? This polyadenylation or poly A tail helps in protecting the mRNA from 3' end till it's moved out of the nucleus up to the cytoplasm, and then translation of this occurs. Now let us see what is the process, that is third process, that is splicing. How splicing occurs? Let's see the splicing here. Splicing means removal of unwanted portions present in the DNA. Okay, so now what happens? Every mRNA in eukaryotic, this is not present in prokaryotic cell. Okay, so every mRNA in eukaryotic cell is having certain sequences that do not code for anything, that are nonsense sequences. Okay, and there are some sequences that are very important sequences, that is that they are the part of the gene. Okay, so now what happens, you can see in this mRNA, this is 5' cap of mRNA and this is poly A tail, and in between there is a presence of whole gene. Okay, so now what happens, there are certain regions, this E, it denotes exons here. Okay, so these regions are necessary regions that codes for gene. Okay, and there is a presence of I region, that is introns, that are present in between these E's. Okay, so these are called as intervining sequences, introns. Okay, so here you can see there are number of introns. Just for example, I have shown you few introns here. So now these introns have to be removed. So whatever the mRNA that is formed at the starting, or the mRNA is just formed, that is called as hnRNA. that is called as HNRNA. HN means heteronuclear RNA, okay? So, because this is that mRNA is not matured yet, so this mRNA is called HNRNA, heteronuclear RNA. So, once the all introns are removed from that mRNA and a proper mature mRNA is synthesized, this mRNA is going for protein synthesis in cytoplasm. That mRNA will be then called as snRNA, that is small nuclear RNA, that is also the mature RNA. Okay, so now let's see what are the different types of introns present within the mRNAs. Okay, so there are 5 different introns that are characterized. There are more also, but 5 are well characterized here. The first type of intron is called GUAG intron. Okay, so this GUAG intron is present in all types of eukaryotic pre-RNAs, means eukaryotic genes, different types of eukaryotic genes. These types of introns is present, that is GUAG introns. In some nuclear pre-RNAs of eukaryotic gene, AUAC intron is also present. Then there are 3 groups, group 1 intron, group 2 intron and group 3 introns. Group 1 intron, these are present in eukaryotic nuclear pre-RNAs. Also in some bacterial mRNAs also, it is present. Some bacterial mRNAs, okay, not all. And then next is group 2 and group 3 introns. These are present generally in the organelle, that is DNA present in chloroplast, then mitochondria, okay, such organelle where the DNA is present, in such kind of organelle where the mRNA is synthesized, there the group 2 and group 3 introns are present, okay. And then there one term is also that's called twintrons, that is generally present in eukaryotic free tRNA, okay. So tRNA genes are also present, yes. So it has twin trons, which has to be removed for the mature tRNA formation, that is the clover leaf structure of the tRNA, okay. So I'll give you an example of GUAG intron first, and then we'll discuss the mechanism. So now let's first see what kind of intron GUAG intron can be, okay. So it's like the GUAG intron will be, for example, suppose the DNA is like this. So GUAG intron, suppose there is some NN, I am mentioning other nucleotides as NNN, okay. Okay, so this is the 3' end. Okay, so this kind of introns are called GUAG intron. You can see here, the splicing site will be present like this. Okay, so whatever the introns present in between. So this is the region where introns are present. So I have mentioned this region as NNNN, means lots of nucleotides are there. So there can be 10 kb of nucleotides present in 2 or 3 introns. Okay, the size of an intron can be up to 10 kb's, okay. So it can be more in certain genes, there are certain exceptions also. So the GUAG intron means what? On the 5' end there will be GU site, after which the DNA will be cleaved, and on the 3' end, on the 5' end on this side, other strand, there will be AG strand. From AG, before AG there will be splicing, okay. So it will be like this, okay, it will be like this. Whatever the splicing that is that will be formed here will be like this. Okay, I'll show you one. Okay, so another on the upper side, it will be like this. Okay, so the cutting of the introns will be like this, and then the exons will be joined together. So it will cut in the splice or cohesive end manner where the exon joining is quite proper afterwards. Okay, so now let us see how the intron splicing mechanism occurs. So let's see the mechanism of splicing. Let's see the mechanism of splicing by GUAG intron. You can see this is the gene here. You can see there is first exon 1, exon 2, and the middle part here, this part is intron here. So GUAG intron it is, okay. So I am explaining the mechanism of GUAG intron. You can see right at the middle of GUAG intron there is the presence of AU base pair. Now what happens, this A does a hydrophilic hydrophilic, that is a nucleophilic attack on this U present at the starting. Okay, so when this does the attack, it breaks the bond there and it forms a structure like this. Okay, so this is a, this structure is called as lariat structure. Okay, now this lariat structure folds away and this UA forms bond here. Okay, so this structure get entangled in itself right at the middle. Okay, and the remaining part here still intact on this side, that is exon 2. So this is on the exon 2 side, it is still intact, whereas exon 1 is now free. Okay, so now the reactive group of C here, OH group of C, attacks on the A present on this side of the GUAG intron. Okay, so now when this attacks here, it breaks the bond at this position. What happens thereby? The two reactive groups of GU and GC are together now. These two are combined together. So E1 and E2, that is exon 1 and exon 2, are combined together here at this position, and the intron that is present in between is removed in this manner as a lariat structure. Okay, so this was the mechanism, simple mechanism of the splicing by GU-AG introns. This GU-AG intron will be present in number of sites. As many new introns are present, it will be present at that different site. Okay, so now let's see what are the different proteins are involved in the mechanism of the splicing and how the splicing occurs. Okay, now let's see the different proteins that are involved in the splicing mechanism. The proteins are called as RNPs, sRNPs, or snRNPs. It is small nuclear riboprotein. So what this protein does, this protein helps in splicing mechanism. Okay, so there are different RNPs here. So for example, U2, U1, U3, U4, U5. Okay, so this helps in the removing of introns. So this is the part present in between here is intron, and the part present at the starting is exon. Okay, so now what happens here, the sequence of exons are also very necessary. Means the E1, E2, E3, likewise the exons should be connected together. It is not like that. For example, the E1 exon will be at the starting, then E3 will be there, and then E2 exon will be there. This is not so, because if this happens, the correct sequence of gene will be not there and it will create problem. Okay, so this is also ensured that all the exons are attached in a correct sequence. Okay, one more thing that is there is a presence of certain sites which looks like, for example, suppose this intron is having GUAG type intron. Okay, for example, GUAG type intron. Okay, so now this GUAG type intron can be present, or this site similar or the sequence similar to the GUAG intron can be present in different exons also. Okay, for example, if such sequences which is present at the starting of the intron is also present in exons, there may be resulting in the exon deletion. Okay, so such kind of sites are called cryptic sites. Okay, these are called as cryptic sites because this can lead to the deletion of the exon, which is an important part of the gene. Okay, so this should not happen because we need a proper gene. Okay, so therefore this snRNPs, this small nuclear riboprotein, helps in proper sequence of the exon, joining the proper sequence of the exon, as well as deleting this cryptic site, or properly splicing only the introns, not from this cryptic site which may be present in different exons. Okay, so now how these proteins does that, I'll explain you in a very simplified manner. These proteins are complex in nature, but I have explained here in a very simplified manner. First of all, there will be a commitment complex where the snRNP U1 and U2 will bind at the two intron site. Okay, so suppose this is the starting site of the intron and this is the ending site of the first intron. Okay, that is present in exon 1 and exon 2, in between exon 1 and exon 2. Okay, now what will happen, this snRNP, there will be attraction between them, that is U1 and U2. Okay, so what will happen, due to this attraction, the splicing site or the intron will be folded and the two exons will be brought close together. Okay, once these two introns or two exons are brought close together, the helix folds like this. Okay, you can see the helix folded in this manner, and here there is a presence of the exon portion. Okay, so the exon portion is folded now. Okay, now there is an entry of U3, U4 and U5 snRNPs. Okay, which will, first of all, it will form a pre-spliceosome complex, means it has prepared the exons for the splicing, and now it forms the spliceosome complex where U3, U4 and U5, these three proteins binds at this position and cuts down from the introns from both sides. Okay, once it has cut down, this whole process or this whole complex of the proteins along with the intron is removed from that site, and consecutive exons, that is E1 and E2, are combined together. Okay, likewise it happens with E2, E3, E3, E4. Likewise, all the exons are linked together, and then a proper snRNA, that is small nuclear RNA, that is mature mRNA, is formed. And now this, the portion remaining, is digested by different nucleases that are present inside the cytoplasm. Okay, so this is how the whole splicing mechanism occurs inside the cell. Okay, so I hope you have understood the whole mechanism. I have explained this mechanism simply, but if you have any difficulty, do comment. If you like the video, please press like button, share, comment and subscribe the channel. Thank you so much for watching.